Alrighty, good morning. Welcome to our Queen Anne's County Board of Education work session for December 21st. I need a motion to go into closed session.
As permitted by Section 3-305B of the General Provisions Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, I move to go into closed session to conduct collective bargaining negotiations or consider matters that relate to the negotiations, compensation, philosophy, and priorities, and an administrative item.
Okay, can I have a motion?
Second.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Okay, is there any questions or comments concerning the motion? Hearing none, I make a motion that we go into closed session. Oh, sorry, all in favor, first of all, say aye. Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Say no. The ayes have it. And now we'll be going into our closed session. Thank you. Alrighty. Okay, I need a motion. Welcome back, first of all. I need a motion to open our closed session.
No, we already did closed session. You need a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
I need a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
So moved.
Can I get a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any questions or comments? Hearing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. The ayes have it. And now we'll turn it over unto Mr. Poliski for our presentations.
So this afternoon in our work session, we'll be beginning our preliminary FY18 workshop, beginning to do the budget analysis. And at this moment, I will turn it over to our Chief Financial Officer, Robin Landgraf, to walk us through some of the documents that she has prepared as we move into our work session.
Okay. I handed out a packet earlier. The first document in the packet is named Maryland Accounting and Reporting Requirements. We get the question often from the community and within the organization as to why we report things the way we report them. And this is basically just some excerpts that I have taken out of the Maryland State Reporting Manual that we're required to follow just to give you an idea so that when those questions arise that you have some background as to why we record things the way that we do. There's essentially six different funds that we need to record our revenues in: the current expense fund, food service fund, school construction, debt service, school activities, and trust agency. The current expense fund, that would be all of our unrestricted and restricted funds. All of our grants would also be part of that. Food service fund, our food service, we currently contract that with Sodexo. However, we're still required to be the reporting agency and to follow all the rules and regulations. We have someone on staff who reviews all of the free and reduced applications and determines who's eligible for that. And then we have to record all of those revenues and the expenditures for any of our food service activities in a separate fund, if you will, a separate set of books from what our current expense fund is. Same thing with school construction. We have several projects that we have going on. Some of this is funded through the state IAC, which Mr. Pinder and Mr. Paluski went within the last couple weeks, Ms. Pullen, to try to get additional funding for Graysonville Elementary School, but that would all be in that fund. Debt service in the state of Maryland, debt service is really not something that is recorded on our books because we're, as a school, we are basically not allowed to borrow money. We do not issue bonds. The county does all of that for us, and they track all of the debt service for the county on their books. School activities, these would be the funds that would be collected at the school level where the kids are paying for field trips or going to the plays or whatever they might be, you know, any activities that would be happening at the school levels. And we do report that in our financial statements in the very back of our books. And then trust agency, this would be any funds that may be coming into us that we're actually just the fiscal agent for those funds. And we currently have two things that we are the fiscal agent for. That would be the Eastern Shore of Maryland Educational Consortium. The consortium itself is made up of the nine counties on the Eastern Shore, and we handle, you know, basically the funds for that. They do some lobbying, they do some, to have meetings with different groups and whatnot and try to coordinate some of the things that are happening on the shore. The other one is dealing with that too, but it's the Eastern Shore of Maryland Educational Consortium Energy Trust. We belong to the trust. We purchase all of our electricity through them on the wholesale market, and then we have somebody who manages that trust, and there's a few fees that are involved with that. We pay Enernoc, which is an energy company who does the analysis of our use of electricity, and then they are the ones that actually purchase the energy on the open market for us. So we are the fiscal agent for those two organizations. They pay us a fee to do that, and a minimal fee, I will say. But we get a fee for doing that, and that all goes through our books. So that will be reported as a trust agency. On the second page, it goes into the current expense fund, which is really the fund that we spend most of our time in. It's either going to be, that's when we set our budget, that's what we're setting is our current expense budget. We also set a capital budget. And essentially, there's four different types of revenue that we have to record. Our local appropriations, which would be any of the funds we receive from the county. Other revenue, generally the types of revenue that we receive would be tuition that we will collect from either non-resident students or from other counties where students are placed in our organization. Earnings on investments, this would be interest on accounts that we have, rent on facilities or buses, and then other miscellaneous revenue. State revenue, the state has a formula that they use to give us different revenue pieces, and we'll see that as we get into the budget a little bit. And then federal revenue, these are primarily grant revenues. You get into the expenditure categories, and there are 13 different expenditure categories, and I'm not going to go through each one and, you know, read what it tells you here, but basically administration, mid-level, instruction, special education, and these are all the categories that we use to record our expenditures. And there is much more detail in the reporting manual than what I've given you here as to what needs to be recorded in each one of these. And then down on the bottom of the third page, you can see there are expenditure subcategories, and this is the salaries, the contracted services, supplies and materials where we have to record. There's six different subcategories under each one of those categories that we have to record our expenses. And as we go through the budget book, you'll see that that's how the budget book is put together. Okay, is there any questions on that particular item? Okay, and then we're going to go to the green page. And I'm also going to ask you to pull out the last thing that I gave you, which was a copy of the approved budget. And if you would flip that open to page 3. And if you look at the first line item on the green page, it says local appropriations current expense fund. And what you have here is a five-year comparison. You'll see it says fiscal year 2012-13. And these are the actual revenues that we collected in each one of those years. And the sixth column over is an average. And then the final column that's on this page is what's in the current year budget. So that final column, if I did my homework right, should tie out to what's in our approved budget. So you can see for fiscal 2017, for local appropriations, $54,187,000 is showing there. For state revenue, and you can see how it's broken down into all of the different pieces, comes up to the $33,600, and then the other revenue comes up to the $474,000.
I see a, what, why is that, is it 88 million in the book and 87 million on the green paper?
I am, 88 million in the book is correct. I'm thinking something, one of my formulas must not be correct on the green paper. So that's basically how it's going to be broken down throughout. The revenues, there's really not much fluctuation in the revenues. There were a couple items that we identified that maybe we needed to look at, and that is under the last section there, revenue tuition. You can see currently we have budgeted $75,000, and our average that we have collected is a little less than 10. This is a really hard number to nail down. A lot of this revenue is for students who are in our county as through the foster care system. So we don't really know from year to year how many of those students that we will have. We used to get more money in this category, so we need to really look at that and then maybe reduce that projected revenue.
Yeah, because I mean that's almost, well, it's more than three times the highest.
Right. There was a time 10 years ago that we were collecting that kind of revenue. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of students in our county, but no longer. The only other one that we really identified was possibly rent on school facilities was an item. You can see our average has only been 234, but you can see the last 3 years we have, you know, had significantly more revenue, so that might be a line item that we need to look to increase. Any questions on?
Where'd you get your figures on all these? This is your best guess estimate. Say, like for that one, you didn't use average; use a percentage over the. You actually use a percentage under the average. Just wondered where you came up with the numbers.
For the current.
Or your.
Well, the 5 years are the actual figures that we collected over those 5 years.
Never mind.
And then.
Belay my last. My mistake.
Yeah. No and worries. Then the last column is the current year budget.
Current year, so. Got it.
Yeah. Okay, so do we have any questions on revenues? Anything that jumps out at any of you that you think that we ought to look at as we're starting to put together this budget?
What is the participation donation fees? Is that
high school athletic?
That was when we had pay to play.
Okay. And
you can see it, we collected it in 12, it was much 13, higher, yeah. And 14, and then in 15 mm-hmm. and 16 we did not, and we have nothing budgeted for the current year because we're not currently doing that.
I'm just going to back up, I'm sorry, for rent or for school facilities, talking about like after-school programs, stuff like that.
These are after-school programs. These are when people are using the buildings on weekends.
Community events,
right. A lot of parks and rec events going on. Churches using the buildings on the weekends.
I really restructured that about 5 years ago so that we were losing money on that and running the buildings. Now, when they come, we restructured it. When they come to us, there's a fee to use the gym. If you would like heat, air conditioning, there's another fee for that. And we, when you see that money there, that's to help offset maintaining the buildings, electric, heat, and all, so that's not coming out of our pockets. So it's, you know, a break even.
Makes sense. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so.
What about bus rentals as well? I mean, I see we have an average, but the 3 years prior, it's well below the average.
Bus rentals, essentially, we had been collecting money from Kent and Caroline County. You can see back in 2012, it was much higher. We were collecting money from other counties and taking students across the bridge when they were going to special schools and whatnot.
So we don't do, we haven't been doing that? And is any chance that we're going to do that again?
Potentially, we could do that. It just depends on which students come forward. I mean, we're taking some students to a specialized school in Baltimore. So basically, to help offset the costs, those they would funnel them to us, and then we would transport them up. It just depends on, you know, the needs of the particular students that we have. So
because if we went by the last, from 2014 to 16, I mean, $10,000 budgeted is well, quite a jump.
Well in excess of what we've actually been
right.
collecting. So, yes, that's another one that we should look at a reduction.
Right.
Okay. Anything else anybody sees on that one? Okay. So now we'll go on to the blue pages. And these are the expenditures. I'm going to ask you to flip over to page 7. In your budget book. Again, try to explain how these sheets correspond to the blue sheets correspond to the budget book. We'll start with the administration, and you see I've under salaries and wages, there's essentially two groups of people separated by a blank line there. So you've got, in the first group, you've got the superintendent, finance officer, human resources officer, supervisor, down to other compensation. So that whole group of people makes up the first line in the budget book. So where in the budget book it says there's $767,199 budgeted, that whole group makes up that $767,000. And then the second group, those two items, the intern and the secretarial support, make up the other $690,000. And I think you'll see that if you look at the seventh column over where it says budget FY 2017 on the blue sheet.
So wait, I want to just get something straight here. So
okay.
On the blue sheet, down to other compensation makes up the 713?
Is that 767.
Right? 767. Or I'm sorry.
Yes, that line.
Okay, so in that 1,207,514, are we just taking out that secretarial and we're coming up with that number?
Could you repeat that question?
So in the blue section where it says, where under the total, where it's 1.2 million?
Under the five-year average on
okay.
the blue sheet.
Yes.
So we're just taking out the secretarial and that the interim support services out of that, and we should get the 7,000 or the 767, correct?
Yeah, if you add those two and subtract them from 1457, you
okay,
get
that's
767.
Okay, that's what I was trying to
right.
figure
right.
making
there's,
sure we
there's
did.
Basically two line items that make up the 1.4. If you look at the budget column, it's 1.457.
Mm-hmm.
So the first section makes up the 767, and then the second section makes up the 690.
Okay.
Do you see that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you need to put your foot up or anything?
Not right now.
Yeah. Okay. I got it. I just want to make sure I was following along right.
Right. And as we went through this, we identified some of our folks, we were going through this budget, what we did is we identified some folks who were being charged in areas of the budget that over time, their job may no longer fall in that area of the budget. For example, supervisor of assessments. We used to have that position broken down because the job that the person was doing was assessments part of the time, and then they were also doing technology instruction. And so they were split between two pieces of the budget. We've now identified that person is really only doing assessment, and we need to move that entire salary into this section of the budget. So we've done some of that as we have gone through this. And I think all those things are listed.
We'll get into that a little bit more
as
we...
On the sheet, as we did this analysis, all those things are listed on there.
And I'll add one thing connected back to the analysis under finance and budget where it says organizational charts. I think one of the things that as you look at this budget, it's very challenging to kind of see who reports to who, what kind of positions within the organization and their organizational functions. Ties a little bit back into Mr. Farley's comments earlier. Where they fit in the function of the organization and where they fall in the budget. That sometime might not be clear because if you look on the administrative sheet in blue, 1005, it says supervisor. Now, in the budget book in 7, it says in there supervisor of assessment 0.5. Mm-hmm. So we need to be a little bit more clear on the positions that we have and then their functions and where they fit in the overall organization.
And she said also that the assessment person was doing also technology. And now they're going to just focus on the assessment part. So is there someone else that's going to pick up the...
Well, that's the, and this in particular place would be Mr. Brown, that has his broad function of that. I think at another time we had maybe more of the technology side where now he really doesn't, where the vast majority of that is in supervising the functionality of assessment, whether that's local assessments or state and federal assessments, the accountability piece. So our discussions have been where does that person best fit in the organization, and then from that piece, where does that best fit as we show the transparency within the budget of where that falls? Because all of it would be difficult as this is written to say, what's the other half of that? Where does that fit? Mm-hmm. Okay.
And to go along with that, I think what we need to understand is it's not necessarily that we're taking job responsibilities away from anybody at this point in time. It is something that has happened over years, and we're just really reevaluating what their job responsibilities are currently and where they really need to fit in this budget. As we were going through that, I think that was one of the things I had the hardest time trying to explain was, well, 10 years ago, their job responsibilities included, you know, this or that or something else. And over time, evolution, if you will, you know, as we get more into the digital age, their job responsibilities don't include those things.
Well, and then going back to what Mr. Farley was presenting earlier, though, that would clear that whole matter up.
That's exactly right.
Yes.
That's exactly right.
Okay.
But then organizationally, where you can look at a chart and say, oh, I see, here's the superintendent, here's the executive staff, underneath them is their responsibilities, who do they supervise, what is that? Is that a 0.5 position? That's a whole position? Mm-hmm. And just try to get some organization to that.
Sure.
Because we should be clearly communicating that in our budget as the resources that we're responsible for.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So then moving forward, the next area of the budget is contracted services. And there's four line items under contracted services, and you can see each one of those. And I've tried to keep this in the same order so that it's easy to crosswalk from one to the other. You'll also notice once we get into this section that I've included two additional columns. And the two additional columns that I've included is comparing the budget to the prior year expenditures, which means the year, fiscal year 2016, and then comparing the budget to what the average expenditures are. And any time, and you can see that, you know, there's 100% or more or less, I have either highlighted in pink or in green, pink meaning it was under budgeted in both instances, where you can see if you look at, for example, in this area, legal fees. We currently have $40,000 budgeted for legal fees. Our five-year average has been $82,000. And our last year, we spent $92,000, a little more than, or almost $93,000. So that is a line item that I draw your attention to, because I think we need to increase that. And that's the way I have worked this throughout the entire budget. Either it's, if it's in pink, then that's a line item that we may need to add additional funds to. If it's in green, that's a line item that maybe we can reduce those funds.
We also need to look at the, just because in our jurisdiction, we use a variety of different law firms, if you will, depending on this specific school law issue that we might be dealing with, using somebody for transportation as it relates to special education. So one of the things which is on your chart in the other of the budget analysis is looking at the current legal services that are being provided to the system, and look at those, if those are contracts, if those are agreements, look at the pricing of those, and look at the level and quality of service that we're receiving as a result of that. So we know that we need to do a little bit more work in this area.
Well, this year we're way over, but nowhere near we were in 2013. Nowhere along the way did we actually meet our expectation. I mean, we exceeded our expectation of our budget, except maybe 2015, just by about $2,000 some odd. So I think it definitely needs addressing. We're way under budgeting.
2013 was, we went into arbitration on the budget. That's why that was so high.
No, it's so low. It's lower than our budget was. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm looking at 15. Yeah, you're right. Yes.
That was, no, we went that long arbitration.
Actually, I'm not. I'm looking at approved for 2015. We budgeted 60,000. Actual in 2015 was only 57,800. So it's a little more than 2,000 that we under budgeted, but everything else, we're way off track every year. We're way off track from budgeted to actual. This year, not being unusually off track, we're consistently off track.
Right.
Okay.
Right, yes. And that is something that I have mentioned each month as we review the expenditures, that we are over in legal fees at this point in time also.
It's obviously over a five-year period, but consistent that it's something we use, we need, we're not budgeting correctly for.
Right.
I would like it or not, we're short here.
Okay. And then if you flip in your budget book over to page 8, then you get into your supplies and materials.
Excuse me.
And overall in this category, we've been budgeting around $50,000, and we've done fairly well. Last year, we were under our budget, and the two preceding years, we were pretty close to what was budgeted.
Can I ask, I mean, being that we are moving to the more technological age, why is our paper, I mean, under that, I know is other things than just paper, but I mean, it seems to be consistent. It's never dropped when we've made an effort to reduce paper.
Maybe under office supplies?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, unfortunately, even though we may be doing more digitally and whatnot, postage has gone up. It actually came down recently, but.
I would like to see, though, if we could note there, like, what we are spending on paper versus in the last 5 years to now.
Yeah, and this is in our executive team meetings, actually something Mr. Farley brought up on our functionality as a school system when it really, especially in his department where you're talking about, we're handling a lot of paper when it comes to application process. And so he's suggested on automation of some of our services that would help to reduce this area as well. So it might, that might be, down the road, it might be a little bit of a front-end load of cost, but over time where we can reduce and improve our efficiencies. I don't know if you want to add anything to that, Mr. Farley.
Well, you know, we're working together to, provide self-service that's fast, doesn't require legs or paper, and creates a record that will meet our needs. So.
I'd like to know how much where each school is getting in paper. Who's using, who's using the most now?
Excuse me.
That's a good point. That's come up in our dialogue as well, even when we're doing individual budgets the last couple of weeks of looking at how much paper is being used.
Okay.
We can put that on our.
Right, that will be under materials of instruction. So, but I did make a note of it.
Okay.
By school. Okay, and then we get to other charges, and there again we have one line item here that we need to address, and essentially it's the board members' expenses. What gets paid out of that is the stipends to the board members, the Maryland Association of Boards of Education dues, and then any time if there's any kind of meetings or whatnot that we would pay for registrations for the board members to belong, to go to, or any, you know, any travel expenses that you might have or whatnot. And essentially what's been driving this cost up a little bit is those MABE association dues have increased over the last couple of years. So we really need to address that. Accreditation is something that we're looking at. This is the money that we have paid for the Middle States accreditation.
How important is that?
Well, it's in many jurisdictions have, although they've gone through the process of accreditation, it's an annual cost, $15,000 a year.
But, what do you get out of it, except for the title of you've been accredited?
That's a question that we're asking, and it's a question that we've asked, Middle States. And
is it kind of like,
there's a way to reduce
the who's who of high school students, or you pay, everybody's name gets in the book.
That have gone through this process because of everybody's looking at.
I would hope not, because that was a big, big, big job getting through that.
Sure.
And it did a lot of, cause us to do a lot of self-reflection, that's what I understand, so.
So there's ways to reduce it, though. There's ways in which you could say each of your high schools that are your feeder systems. So basically, your feeder systems are accredited, essentially all of your schools. You can still carry that title. But we pay for each individual school.
Oh, my gosh.
So there's a way that we think of when we've talked with the Middle States saying, how have other school districts that still want to be able to keep their accreditation, but how have they reduced the cost?
I would like just to know what is the benefit of being accredited by Middle States? Like, do our students put on their college applications that they came from a county that's accredited by Middle States and that helps them get in? I just want to know what the benefit is of having this accreditation.
And I think that's a valid question that many school systems have asked themselves. Being accredited, although it is a process of reflection and improvement, and it's got value in that, there's really no sanctions that you have to be hold an accreditation. All of the work that we do, which is tied to the State Department in Maryland, the regulations in the state of Maryland, and the law that we have to uphold. So that's information that we'll continue to collect, and we'll, and that is, you'll see that on our analysis chart under other, that is the second thing.
Oh, okay.
And it's in our
because analysis. At some point, all schools have to have middle accreditation, right? I mean, in the state of Maryland? I mean,
No, they don't have to have it.
Okay.
Many jurisdictions have completely cut it. They've gone through the accreditation. They went through the process. They were accredited. But due to looking at finances, I mean, the same question that we're asking
right.
is, what are we getting out of
right.
spending
what's the benefit?
$20,000 a year?
Exactly.
We've gone through the process.
And we've done it. Right.
And that's what, when I spoke specifically with a lady from the middle states, you know, we're not the only ones that are asking this question.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when she said, well, you know, some jurisdictions have reduced that by just carrying the cost to their high schools, which is about $1,500, but that ensures the feeder system is still accredited.
I just want them to show me what we're getting.
12 schools go into those two schools no matter what,
yeah,
basically.
Okay.
Maybe if we're not getting anything, what would it, how would it hurt us if we weren't? What
yeah,
would be right. the repercussions?
Exactly. What is our benefit? Yeah.
Are we drawing students to our county as residents because we are? Are we giving our children an up on college applications because we are? If all of those are no's, well, if we don't do it, what are we going to lose?
Right.
Yeah.
And I think there's a lot of jurisdictions that have gone away from that. There's no law. There's no repercussions per se.
A lot of jurisdictions
Although,
locally.
Yes.
On the
here
shore.
On the Eastern Shore.
Interesting.
Here in Maryland.
I was going to say Maryland.
Is 13,000 not 20?
Okay.
13,000 is what's currently budgeted.
Okay. And when did we begin that and start paying that?
That would have.
Do we know?
Certainly proceeded.
How many years we've done?
I'm sorry.
12. When did we become accredited and start paying this fee?
They came from what 2 years ago.
It was longer than that.
It was much longer.
Our high schools were accredited even
Prime.
Before we
Ms.
went with
Ms.
a system-wide accreditation.
Well.
But the system-wide, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago that we
I
did
would,
that.
Yeah, I'm trying to think.
That
yeah, it was easily 4 years ago.
Yeah, I've been gone.
I think it's important for every institution to have a reflective framework, a self-analysis, especially one that spans over time and allows you to look at the net benefits of your investments and of your strategies. So whatever you decide, whether it's middle states or something else, and maybe it's the curriculum audit framework or whatever it is, stick to it long enough to know if you're achieving the results you're investing
yeah.
in.
Right. Well, I mean, we've been with this quite a while, so we should be able to tell now if it's worth keeping or losing or not. So
we could also check with other schools that have decided to go away from
what has happened to them. Is it good for 4 years or 5 years? Because we're due for a recheck.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's five. We just last year just did the midpoint check. We had to do a reflection.
We did. Okay.
We did. We turned that in last December, I believe.
Okay. And we do so. We do it one, like every 2 or 3 years. You reflect. But
you
what,
do.
Mr.
We
ha-
there's a in this case they didn't come on site to go through that, but we had to produce a document that was a reflective document as to, what have we done since we went through the accreditation. And so one of the big reflections is, as a school system, that we didn't do much in that area. One is, part of that reflection is there was turnover in curriculum instruction that time. So, no fault to anyone. But, those are things that we had to reflect on, which is looking at, we've gone through it. It was an honor and kind of a feather in our cap to go through that. And then that's the question, the reflective is, that framework or any other framework, what are we getting out of $13,000, $14,000 that we're paying every year? Is there a service that we're getting as a result of that?
And what would we lose if we didn't?
And what would we lose if we didn't? And right now I can't find of what we're getting for spending that amount of money that we're getting back from that organization. We've gone through it. We were accredited. We got the stamp. But now that we're paying into it,
Yeah.
What's the return on investment?
Your reflection occurred what year? What year did we, you said it was a midterm reflection?
Yeah, and I knew Mr. Engel had done that. I believe it was last, so it would have been in 16, I believe, last year.
Okay.
And in my understanding, that was year two or three. I can double check on that, Captain
Kelly. Just wondered, yeah.
Sure.
I don't remember doing that. All I knew is this due up is coming up, if we wanted to redo the whole thing or not.
Yeah, and noted on our analysis chart.
Okay. Then we go through the travel, the subscriptions and dues, meetings and conferences, and all those line items look comparable to what we have done. However, we have listed a couple of those, the meetings and conferences, for one of, you know, areas where we want to look at. We want to look at those a little more in depth, and decide whether we really need to keep those types of line items in our budget. Again, with the recruiting and then professional improvement, in this particular area, this professional improvement is money that we set aside for our support employees to be able to get some additional PD.
Is our recruiting the superintendent search figure in there?
No, that would have been in last year's. If you look on the blue sheet, back up under consultant, under contracted services, the last item there says consultants, and for fiscal year 2016,
$32,000.
Okay. That was the money that was set aside for that superintendent search. And then in the budget book, that now brings us over to page 9. And the last item there is under transfers, outgoing transfers. And this $10,000, that's our cost to belong to the Eastern Shore of Maryland Educational Consortium. And each of the 9 counties on the Eastern Shore pay that on an annual basis to run that operation. And that is essentially administration. Do you have any questions? I know that this is, you know, you're just getting your first glance at this, so I'm sure that there will, as you have an opportunity to analyze some of these numbers, and there are an awful lot of numbers on these pages, that you'll have more questions for us. Then we get into mid-level administration, which begins on page 11 of the budget book, and will be on page 2 of 10 in your blue sheets. And again, we've got the same kind of breakdown. The principals, so under the 2 line items, principal and auto allowance flow into the 1 line item in the budget book. There's principals. Same thing with assistant principals, secretary, and clerical. And I've tried to group them on your blue sheet so that you can see which numbers go together to equal the number that's in the budget book. And again, this is an area that we have taken a deep dive into who is charged in this category, and we will be moving some folks into this area of the budget, and we'll be moving other folks out of this area of the budget based on what their current job responsibilities are and where they best fit in that overall framework of how we're supposed to report them according to the MSDE reporting guidelines.
Do we know if that's going to make a major impact on the numbers, or is it going to kind of be a wash?
I don't know off the top of my head. I'm thinking an overall number of people, it's probably going to be pretty close to the same, mm-hmm. but we're going to be moving supervisors in, some secretaries at. So I'm not really sure exactly how the numbers are going to wash.
Gotcha.
I have a question. Can we, I'm not sure that it can be on here, but can we know as to each school, how much the principal makes at each school and how much their auto allowances, and the same with the assistant principals?
Sure.
I think that we should know what each school is doing.
What do you mean by auto allowances?
Where it says auto allowance.
Oh, for their car?
Yeah.
They get a stipend or a payment once a year to each of the principals and assistant principals. And basically what it is for all the night times that they have to come back to the school, all of the things on weekends where they're returning to the school.
Right.
And basically, rather than them having to submit a mileage form and asking for reimbursement, we give them a lump sum each year. And then it's up to them as to whether they keep track of it and take it off when they're fine. You know,
well, I guess that's what I'm asking. That's what I'd like to see is to, out of that 14 or 1.4, who, what school, what principal is making what at each school, and then that auto allowance, how much we're giving to each one of those principals at that school for that auto allowance. And not just the principals. I'd like to see the assistant principals also.
And we, you'll notice on the analysis sheet in other, the second to the last one down, which has mileage slash, that's a larger bucket, but I'm sorry, Annette, it would be in this.
On that
which,
one?
Yeah, which you weren't here for that component.
I see it right here under other.
Yep.
It's white. Looks like this. It's its own paper.
There it is. So this, just quickly, this is a reflection that the executive staff has done in areas that we've identified that we need to take a deeper dive into about how using those resources. You'll see in other, just so your point,
right,
where it says mileage,
right,
we'll certainly add as we're looking at all of that to principals as well.
Like if you're going to lay out the salaries of these people, and we need to know what went into making that salary to longevity, is
sure,
we
we can show you the.
I doubt they're going to have the exact same salaries for each.
Because there are different factors,
and I'm
whether
not
that's enrollment or years of experience.
Right.
Yeah.
There are other.
I just
criteria.
Want basically what I want to know is how we come to that $1.4 million as to how many 14 principals, how that is.
It's 1.6 though. You're on the. You're on.
I'm
the
in the
first,
wrong month.
You're
okay,
in the first.
Yeah,
it's
wrong, I'm in the first.
You're
yeah.
in the right place.
Right, right,
just
right.
The wrong year.
Yeah,
sure.
Sorry. Sure. That's what I'm trying to see is, you know, it's not how long we've been here or for either or the principal or the assistant principals.
Sure.
It's just, you know, what is the breakdown of that 1.5 million out of 14 principals? Who's getting what? And and especially that auto allowance, is that divided evenly among all 14?
All elementary school
principals
get the same.
That's
okay.
All
that's
school
yeah.
Principals
so they're
get
all
the
getting
all high school.
So you could take.
You,
oh, okay. All right. So that's
let's
okay.
Break it down by
okay,
level.
Okay.
Which
okay.
Level
based on
they
what
get a
we
stipend.
Think each group of them is going to have to
okay,
do
okay.
aside from
they
their
stipend,
regular
yeah.
duties.
Right.
All right. So okay. That's
it's
great.
A flat.
Great.
A flat.
So that's yes.
okay.
consistent.
Great.
That's consistent.
Yes, and basically the way it is calculated is. We assume that they're going to spend 1,600 miles, or and that's just off the top of my head.
Right.
That might not
right,
be the
right.
right number. And it's multiplied by whatever the current reimbursement rate is for mileage.
Okay.
So as that reimbursement, that mileage reimbursement rate at the federal and state level fluctuates, so does that figure that they're paid.
Did we ever do it the other way where they did do an expense sheet and turn it in for mileage and blah, blah, blah? And if we did, have we seen a better balance of
well, that's a good question.
Are we saving some and money over that laborious process that somebody had to look at those numbers and cut that check and do that and blah, blah,
well,
blah,
see,
blah.
See, I personally think that they should have to, at the end of the year, that they should have to account for where that money went to.
Well, it's
I mean, they may not have to do it all the whole every time they use it, but at the end of the year, they need to keep receipts.
Yeah. I'm
and turn
say
those receipts in
25 years ago.
Uh-huh.
we did it the other way, where they had to keep track and turn in all of their mileage and turn in all of their receipts and whatnot. And at that time, the board and the superintendent decided that it was very laborious to go through all of that and then try to reimburse them, that they would rather just give them a flat fee. And then it was up to the individual to keep track of those receipts and their...
But we didn't ask for proof.
We did not ask for proof.
And I don't think we should.
Because we include it as part of their salary.
We know they're there.
And they get taxed on it.
We know they show up to these things.
Right.
Well, and I will tell you, is other jurisdictions that have wrestled with the same thing have found the opposite, that have found once you ask them in the accountability of where you're going,
you find out you're not really paying them enough. Yes.
We were paying them more.
Oh, paying them more.
What they were
actually doing. Oh, but it could work the other way too.
That's right.
That they're doing a whole lot more for a lot less than had they produced receipts.
Sure.
It's a balance there.
Plus, you have to consider
the salary. I would think it takes three people to do that.
Yeah,
yes.
The salary of the person who does the work once the material
accounting for it, getting it in the system, getting it to payroll. You're talking about a lot of fingers having to do a lot of work there. Trust me, I've done that kind of stuff. It's not fun.
But it also, and we do have employees that do that. And I think this is another good plug for Mr. Farley's about automating our system where we're reducing that kind of paperwork.
Right.
So we could do it electronically, do it a lot faster.
Exactly.
And keep, and ensure that we're keeping accurate records.
Right, right.
Because is it from where I start at work or is it where I start at home?
Right, right. I mean, but we're looking at $14,000 over 14 schools.
They're not getting a lot of money.
It's $100 a month.
No.
It's $100 a month if they drive a
Suburban.
Expedition or but Suburban.
It's still
not even a fill-up.
They still need to be held accountable when we're handing them taxpayers' dollars as to where that money is going.
Well, then we might have to be in the position where we do that for every stipend position then. If we're going to do it for one, are we going to do it for all?
I agree with that.
Do the paperwork.
I mean, somehow we decided the stipend process, and somehow we decided that certain things were better handled that way than from an line item budget situation. Mm-hmm. Maybe go back and review why those decisions were made based on what, instead of recreating the wheel and doing it all over again. Maybe we should go back and just kind of review that so we are clear why that changed, and that might answer our questions as to whether we need to relook at it or not.
I know we had one of the supervisors to actually do it. And she was into October, and money was spent, and her stipend was spent, and she still had the rest of the year where she was getting no additional money.
I could see that easily.
You know, I think it probably can go either way, especially for the CNI staff. They definitely
they have
are
a lot
on
of state
the
meetings.
A lot.
They're across the bridge.
Yes. Well, even a local principal who lives at one end of this county and teaches at another. I mean.
Yeah, well, they don't get paid for
I know, but to work.
It's for the evening coming back.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. To come back to that particular event, that can add up really quickly.
Right. And this accounts for all in-county travel.
Right.
So if the principals are coming to the A&S meeting, you know, once a month, they have a elementary school principals meeting, middle school high. All of that travel that they're doing within the county, coming here to the central office for, you know, meetings and whatnot, is part of that stipend.
You can come
they're,
up with
they're
this
not getting
so
paid
fast.
Extra.
It's not that much money.
I mean, at first it does look, and I'm in Annette's corner with this. At first, it's a $15,000.
Oh, I'm not. No. Wait.
But when
minute.
You start mm-hmm. thinking about it, it's not.
Yeah, but that's not what I'm saying. I think that we just have to make people accountable for money that we give them. I'm not looking at the $15,000 and saying that that's too much or too less. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that the budget's going to be different this year, and if that's the case, then we have to hold people accountable for giving receipts, rather it's more or less or whatever.
Do you want them to prove it, or a mileage?
You know, I own my own business and I drive and I use that on my taxes, but I still have to keep receipts and I still have to keep, you know. That's all. That's all I'm asking, and I'm not saying that it's not that we're giving them too much or too less. That quite obviously we're not giving them enough. That's not what I'm saying. I just think that we need, and you could go down this whole line, everyone that's given money for something other than their paycheck.
But is this, one question though, but I mean, this stipend, this auto allowance is just going to be, it's under a line item of auto allowance, but technically it's part of their salary because of the auto allowance.
They're being taxed on it.
Right.
Oh, they are being taxed on it.
Right.
So there isn't any really way, I mean, it would probably be really fruitless to have them do all that, because it's not like they can take that money and spend it on something else, because
no.
It's a separate thing.
Right.
It's just
right.
They get it included.
Right. I think yeah. The difference is that's what a stipend is to sort of eliminate a lot of paperwork and a lot of accountability, because somebody has determined the level of the stipend is equal to or less than or more than what is really necessary for the deserved duty. If we were just going into a stipend situation, mm-hmm. we would go back to their past accounting history and their receipts mm-hmm. and all of that to review them to see mm-hmm. how we set the stipend. But usually when you're given a stipend, you're not asked to account for it. It's one way or the other. Doesn't have to be, but 99 out of 10 times it is. To eliminate a lot of paperwork as well.
Just like when we pay an athletic stipend or an extra
Absolutely.
Duty stipend, it's without
Absolutely.
Regard to the specific hours worked.
Yes.
It's just you agree to do this thing, and in return you get this amount.
And it might be a whole lot more hours this year than it was last year, and then next year it might be less, but you're still getting the same amount. You're doing your duty. You're showing up to the games and the practices and all the things that go along with that reason for a stipend, but not necessarily an accounting of every time item.
So right. We have that noted in the other column.
Because we were going to look at that anyway, right?
Okay. Mm-hmm. But then that brings us down to, I guess we're now on page 12 of the budget book.
Could you go over those red highlighted ones on commencement?
Oh, we haven't gotten there yet.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Page 12 of the budget book is actually where the commencement
expenses are. We're still on 2 in that
blue sheet. Never mind, sorry.
We are still on 2 in the blue sheet, but we are now on page 12 in the budget book. Okay. So under supplies and materials, we actually reduced that going into the current year by $5,000. And looking at our trend data, that's fine for the last year. Actually, the last year, but over time, we would be short in that category. But I think that we have brought those expenditures down, and we've been staying within that now. The next group is other charges, and this is where, Captain Kelly, you were talking about commencement. Mm-hmm. You can see we have budgeted for commencement expenses $22,500, and we have been consistently, at least for the last 4 years, over budget on that line item, so that's a line item that we need to look at.
Has anybody looked into with commencement?
Community college?
Yeah, holding it at the community college, because that would eliminate your security with the and rental. I mean, the rental would just be to the college itself. You wouldn't have all that rental equipment and supplies. I just wondered if there's, one, it would be a big enough facility, and two, what the cost associated, would it be cheaper to do it there or not?
So.
And then you wouldn't have to worry about weather and setting up two things and overtime of staff setting up.
If you're looking with to stay within county, Chesapeake College isn't big enough.
It's not, okay.
Not even close to it. Our biggest, I mean, some of the biggest items right there, we set up outside and inside,
right.
You know, obviously. So then you're talking about, we bring every chair that we have from every school, and we have to rent chairs. The sound system, we have to get sign language interpreters. And that varies, but yeah, out of county, yeah, we could go somewhere. I mean, but that would just be it. Do people want to travel to watch graduation? So,
Because I know it wasn't, is it in Annapolis or somewhere across the bridge? I know they use that equestrian center.
Yeah, I do.
And a lot of schools use it.
They
like
do.
Multiple graduations they do. There.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm.
So we've identified this area as well in the other category, and fourth one down of commencement exercises, okay, that we need to do a deeper dive into that and look how mm-hmm. we can stay under budget and look at that expense and see if we can't reduce it.
Yeah, well, because I believe I was last year when we were talking about commencement, it was something like the porta potties alone were like $8,000, I believe, or something I remember on the line item. It was thousands of dollars.
It is just setting the things up.
Right,
it is thousands
of
dollars. I don't remember the exact cost.
I feel like, are they necessary? I mean, when we have like a state football thing there filled with people, we don't get extra porta potties for that. We have maybe just as many, if not more, people coming for that. I don't know. Would it make more sense? Like
that's something we can talk to both principals about to see, hey, you know, what is your reason?
Do we open the school up for the bathrooms or the, you know, plus you have it at the stadium?
All good questions that we're asking ourselves. Engage the high school principals in it.
Okay.
That is something that we're over budget.
Yeah, that we have identified as something that we need to evaluate further. And then the last two items there, dues and subscriptions and meetings and conferences, again, those are items that we have identified that we need to do a deeper dive and take a look at what's actually being spent. I know a big part of that dues and subscriptions on that particular line item is the National School Board Association and the ASCD, which I can't off the top of my head think what it stands for.
Association of Supervision Curriculum Development.
There you go. Those are the ones that come out of there that are fairly expensive. Which brings us to instruction. We're now 10 minutes before 2. I don't know if we want to continue or if we want to...
Let's go as far as we can up until this allotted time. And
Okay, so it starts on the bottom of page 2 on the blue forms, and it will begin on page 14 in the budget book. And there's quite a few... starts on the bottom of page 2 of 10 and goes down about a quarter of the way on the top of 3 of 10 of all the items that are included as part of this teacher full and part-time. You see this is classroom teachers, your academic deans, your guidance counselors, your psychologists, your media specialists, teacher specialists, reading and math specialists, ESOL teachers, alternative program, all those things are included in this. Saturday, the next group, instructional assistants and tutors, starts with Saturday school and goes down to extended day.
Those you estimated pretty high as opposed to the budget 5-year average. Just about every one of those, right? It appears to be higher in almost every category.
Well, and I would expect that because as salaries go up, as people got steps and whatnot, I would expect that the current year budget would be...
Okay. I see.
Would be higher than the average.
Because we did give those raises.
Right. And that's why on these, I didn't do a budget... a percentage of the budget, you know, for the prior year, because, I mean, if you look at all of these line items, for the most part, they're going to increase year after year as you're giving step increases or COLA increases. As long as the teachers or the personnel within each of the line items would stay the same, then you would expect that would be an increase in cost each year.
I have two questions here.
Okay.
Number one, the substitute teachers. Why are we budgeting 350 when our 5-year average is close to 500?
That's also one that we've been looking at. The theory behind that in the past has been We know that we will have a certain amount of attrition each year, and rather than taking money, new money that we're getting and putting it on that particular line item, we would rely on having that attrition to cover that additional cost. That is something that we've had some discussion about as to whether that should continue, that theory.
Because it hasn't worked, right?
Well, it does
work. So that's what we want to be, you know, and that's the conversation we had, is that if that's what we're spending and that's what it is, then we need a budget for that. And, you know, there's another piece to this, which is fourth quarter, what we call fourth quarter transfer money, that end of year money that we use to operate our system. And we need to get out of that cycle. We need to, if this is what we're spending, and this is what we need to budget.
Yeah,
and not,
this is actual.
Exactly.
And not rely on attrition to fund that. And so moving forward as part of this, putting together this next budget, that's why we want to look at what are we spending, make a, you know, a good, hard, realistic number to that and see if we can't reduce that, but to be more realistic on what our expenses are.
Is a large amount of that substitute teachers for positions that we don't have filled? Or is it just basically our operating substitutes to fill in for our sick teachers and our maternity leave teachers and that kind of thing?
It's not just teachers, though. It's also
right.
Instructional
nurses,
so it's
parents,
a very
anything.
It's a very good gauge of what we've been doing.
Yes.
To push us towards what we need to do. It's not padded. It's not, we didn't have a bad year. It's pretty indicative of what the needs are.
Yeah.
Well, you'll see
year
some
year
outlier years between like 2014 and then to FY16.
Right.
Actual was a.
But I'm looking at the 5-year average.
Correct. Right.
Then looking at the budget and, yeah.
That's right. Exactly right.
There may be other things we could do. You know, for instance, the collective bargaining agreement for teachers provides for an incentive when they have perfect attendance. Perfect attendance drops down our sub costs. So we probably need to take another look at it and see if there's other things we could do.
And you'll see that's in our analysis sheet in other
incentives.
Sixth one down is substitutes as an area we've identified. We've got to take a deeper dive into.
My other question was the in-school suspension. I know that the 5-year average is low, but the actual budget is right on target. But can you explain to me what that cost is for in-school suspension? Like, is that, I don't know what that is.
In-school suspension, we have at both of the high schools, we have a school assistant position. Where children go when they have been.
So it's an actual person that we're paying to for in-school suspension?
Yes.
Is this one in each high school or one in each middle school?
In middle school.
So how many persons do we have?
I'm thinking it's actually, Janet just asked that same question. It may be middle schools and not the high school. I would have to go back and look.
So at least
see.
Four people then.
But do they do that full time, or is that a collateral for?
It's full time.
Full time. Okay.
The other thing, going forward, that we want to ensure that we do, whether we're looking at, and it speaks to this, is whether we're in the instructional book on page 14 as Robin's going through this, or we're going through the blue sheet. What this doesn't tell us is how many positions are in that
right.
bucket or in that category. Are we talking 2? Are we talking 10?
Well, that's why I was asking.
400. So whether it's in either one of these books, you'll see in 14 where it says 525 positions. Well, what's the breakdown of within all those categories?
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing.
I had no idea that we had staff just for in-school suspension. None at all.
Mm-hmm.
So we have that on our, we'll put that under instructional services as to do a little deeper dive into that.
Is that something that's mandatory?
In school?
Well, they have to be
in school suspension.
Alternative to out of school.
Right.
Alternative
to
out of school.
What is that?
It's an alternative to out of school suspension.
Right.
So the students are continuing to learn.
They're doing the work.
Yeah.
And maybe if that's the case, then maybe then somebody needs to start paying that bill other than the school system. If your child's not going to attend, school for being, because they're being suspended or whatever it is, maybe that needs to become a something that
there's no
a parent needs to pay.
See, I guess I thought that's what anchor points was for. When you had a kid in trouble, they went there. Mm-hmm. I know that there's limited in-school suspension. Like, there could be, like, just a week, a day, right. You know, depending on what the thing was. I just, honestly, that just took me by surprise because I didn't realize there would be four full-time positions for just in-school suspension. For just that.
The crimes are really not that serious, so they give them an alternative to stay in school, finish their work.
Kind of like our old detention.
You know, stay up to school. There was a teacher there.
It's detention.
Yeah.
Detention.
Yeah. Detention. Yeah.
And there's got to be some adult in charge of that group of children that are in that room.
Yeah. And I don't think they're certified people that's in there.
No. Yeah. Right. Yeah, right.
But we want them to keep learning while they're not.
Sure. Well, we're responsible for it, especially with some kids who have IEPs and 504s.
Right.
So we really keep spend learning because we have to document how we supported the learning while that child was receiving a punishment.
Exactly.
Greg, did you, you want under instruction in that sheet, you want to in-school suspension to deeper dive?
In-school suspension, we also have to add in there, maybe that's under operations, will be paper cost as well. That was further noted.
What are we going to talk about with in-school suspension? You just want another definition, right?
Well, I just, I was like how many positions,
because
this has been questionable. So I just want to know what that entails.
Sure.
Yeah, good question.
Okay.
Okay, we've talked about teacher substitutes. Secretarial clerical is the next group, and this is essentially the clerical staff for the guidance offices and the athletic offices, athletic department. And then other instructional positions. These are your homebound, your extra duty. This is where we're talking about the stipends for the coaches or for the department chairs, team leaders. You were talking about Centerville Middle School where they had changed who got the stipends. Essentially what we do is each elementary school is allowed 8 positions to be paid. Middle schools are allowed 12. And then the high schools, those are mostly listed in the negotiated agreement. But these are environmental club or the SGA and it has been at the discretion of the principal of the school to determine which activities are taking place in their school and who should be compensated for those activities. So it has, you know, that can change from year to year. But that's where that money is budgeted.
What line item was that again? I'm sorry.
Extra duty.
Extra duty. Okay, thank you.
And then you have a computer technician and webmaster, and that's really, the computer technician is actually a misnomer. That really should be a data analysis person. And that's somebody that we're also, as part of the descriptions and making sure they're in the right spot in the budget, that's somebody that we're also looking to move.
Could a computer technician and a webmaster, I mean, is that something that totally different job descriptions? Are they? Okay.
Yeah, yes. Webmasters is that school based.
Oh, that's when they pick a teacher that does it. Oh, gotcha. Okay, I'm good.
Right, that's a stipend for them. Okay, and then we get down to workshop participants, mentors, and workshop participants for SIT. And these are all items, especially the SIT team. Stipends is something that we're going to be looking into. The mentors, we're looking into what was requested in the budget for them, because as you know, tenure went from being 2 years to 3 years, so the number of mentors that we've been having available for our novice teachers has increased over the years, so we need to reevaluate that budget because it has remained the same for years. And that's essentially salaries and wages for under the instructional portion of the budget.
We are at 2 o'clock at our allotted time. This is only the beginning of our preliminary budget workshop as we craft the budget for FY18. Are there any questions, any comments? You've given us some great feedback, some things that we've got to go back and take a look at.
No, I do appreciate the breakdown of it. In the past, we haven't done it this way, and I do. I think it's easier to understand.
I was going to say you can understand it this way.
Draws attention easily to areas that we may need to look at. So I appreciate that.
Okay. Sure.
I need a motion to adjourn the meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Sorry.
Any questions or comments? Hearing none. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Consider yourselves dismissed.